Good day to all. Today I'm taking this lecture on material science. I would like to just recap what has been done in my previous class. In the lecture 1, I spoke about the classical free electron theory. The theory was explained by Drude and Lorentz. The conductivity of metals based on the electrons that are being present in the outermost orbit of the atom, named the valence electrons or free electrons. However, this theory failed for a number of reasons, and we observed two important failures of the classical free electron theory. The first failure we observed is the temperature dependence of the electrical conductivity, where we observe the conductivity is inversely proportional to the square root of the temperature, which is in no agreement with the experimental observation, where the conductivity is inversely proportional to the temperature. The second observation is the conductivity is just based on the number of electrons present in the given conductor. But we have observed that copper, having less number of electrons, is a better conductor compared to that of aluminium. And all these drawbacks been explained through a new theory developed by Sommerfeld called quantum free electron theory. And here we spoke about the various formation of the bands when large number of atoms are being brought closer to each other, and how these energy levels were distributed from the lower energy to the higher energy level, and also what kind of distribution, how many number of energy levels are there per unit volume, per unit energy of the system, and that was explained through density of states. Now, we'll try to derive the expression for the Fermi energy at 0 Kelvin. We already come across G of E dE as the density of states, which means to say the number of energy states per unit volume in the range E and E plus dE. And F of E as the probability of occupation of electrons. Therefore, we can find the total number of electrons that are present within this energy range E and E plus dE is given by N of E dE is equal to G of E dE into F of E, which means to say G of E dE is the number of energy state present within the range E and E plus dE, and F of E is the probability of the electrons present in it. And if you try to take the product, it will going to give you the total number of electrons present within the range E and E plus dE. Now my aim is to find out what are the total number of electrons present per unit volume of the material. And to find out, I can integrate N of E dE from E is equal to 0 to E is equal to maximum. And this is going to give you the total number of electrons per unit volume of the material. But N of E dE is nothing but it is G of E dE into F of E. So I can try to substitute. If I write N is equal to integration of G of E into F of E into dE, from E is equal to 0 to E maximum, where E maximum is the maximum energy possessed by the electrons. But if you see, the probability of the electrons at absolute 0 Kelvin is going to be equal to 1, which means to say all the electrons below the Fermi level at absolute 0 Kelvin are occupied. Therefore, I can write F of E is equal to 1. Hence, I can write the above equation. N is equal to integration of G of E d from E is equal to 0 to E is equal to maximum. But we already come across G of E d is nothing but 8 root 2 into pi into m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into e to the power half into d. Therefore, let me try to substitute this part of the equation in the above equation. I can write N is equal to 8 into root 2 into pi into m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into integration of e to the power half d from e is equal to 0 to e maximum. Here 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 by h cube is a constant. And the only variable is the energy, that is e to the power half. So what is the integration of e to the power half? The integration of e to the power half is equal to e to the power 3 by 2 divided by 3 by 2, which is nothing but 2 by 3 into e to the power 3 by 2. So I can write the above equation as n is equal to 8 root 2 into pi into m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into 2 by 3 into e to the power 3 by 2 from e is equal to 0 to e maximum. And at absolute 0 Kelvin, the maximum energy that an electron can have is equal to F naught. That is the highest energy in which an electron can have at absolute 0 Kelvin, which is equal to the Fermi energy, which I can write it as EF naught. Therefore, I can write n is equal to 8 root 2 pi into m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into 2 by 3 into EF naught to the power 3 by 2. Or this can be written as 8. Now here we have root 2 and here there is a 2. Therefore, I can write 2 to the power 3 by 2 into m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into pi and 3 here. So I can try to write together pi by 3 into EF naught to the power 3 by 2. But this equation can be rearranged and written for F naught to the power 3 by 2 as h cube divided by 8m to the power 3 by 2 into 3n divided by pi. Here 8 into 2 to the power 3 by 2 into m to the power 3 by 2 can be together put as 8m into to the power 3 by 2. Or I can write for EF naught as h square divided by 8m into 3n by pi whole to the power 2 by 3. Therefore, this is the expression for the Fermi energy at absolute 0 Kelvin. And this equation is going to clearly tell us that the Fermi energy at absolute 0 Kelvin depends on only the number of electrons present per unit volume of the material. That is how the EF naught value is going to be different for different material. Like in the case of copper, the number of electrons are just different than that of the aluminium. So EF naught is simply going to depend on the number of electrons, and rest all the factors, that is h square, m and pi, are all constant. So I can just try to put them together as EF naught is equal to b into n to the power 2 by 3, where b is nothing but it is h square divided by 8m into 3 by pi to the power 2 by 3, which whole is a constant, and it can be found as 5.85 into 10 to the power minus 38 joules. Therefore, just by knowing the total number of electrons that are present per unit volume of the material, we are able to find out the Fermi energy of any given material at absolute 0 Kelvin. And this equation clearly tells that more and more is the number of electrons per unit volume of the material, there are more and more is the Fermi energy. Say for the example, copper. Copper has only 8.45 into 10 to the power 28 number of electrons, and it's a Fermi energy approximately around 7 electron volts. But the aluminum has got more number of electrons, so naturally its Fermi energy is going to be more. So the Fermi energy entirely depends on the total number of electrons that are going to be present per unit volume of the material. Now let us try to find what is the Fermi energy if the temperature of the material is increased, or whether the Fermi energy depends on the temperature. To understand that, the Fermi energy at any given temperature is given in the expression EF is equal to EF naught into 1 minus pi square by 12 into KT divided by EF naught whole square. Now this is a derived expression for the Fermi energy at any given temperature. And this equation tells that EF, that is the energy at any given temperature, is equal to EF naught, which is the energy at 0 Kelvin, into 1 minus pi square by 12 into KT by EF naught whole square. Now there is a factor T. So EF is actually depends on the temperature. But the value pi square by 12 into kt by f naught to the power square is a very, very, very small quantity. And since it is a very small quantity, the whole quantity can be neglected. The whole quantity can be neglected. Therefore, I can say, except at extremely high temperature, the second term within the bracket is so small and it can be neglected. Hence, I can write F is simply equal to F naught, which means to say that at normal temperatures, the Fermi energy is independent of the temperature. It may change at a very, very large temperature, but at normal temperature, the Fermi energy is not going to change. Hence, we can conclude that the Fermi energy is independent of the temperature. Let us come across the next term, that is the Fermi velocity. Now, what is exactly the Fermi velocity? Fermi velocity is the velocity of the electrons at the Fermi level. Very simple definition. We already come across the energy levels where the highest occupied level of the electron at absolute zero Kelvin is the Fermi energy. And there are electrons at the Fermi energy. The velocity of those electrons at the Fermi level is the Fermi velocity. And to calculate the Fermi velocity, let us try to use the equation Fermi energy, which is equal to half mvf square, where vf is the velocity of the electrons at the Fermi level. So by rearranging this, we are able to get the equation for the Fermi velocity as vf is equal to square root of 2 into ef divided by m. This is the expression for the Fermi velocity of the electrons. However, mass of the electron is a constant. So I can simply say that the Fermi velocity is directly proportional to square root of the Fermi energy. The next terminology which comes here is the Fermi temperature. Let us try to understand what is Fermi temperature. The definition says the temperature at which the average thermal energy of the free electron in a solid becomes equal to the Fermi energy at zero Kelvin. Now, to understand this concept, let us try to see the diagram here. Here in the first diagram, we know at absolute zero Kelvin, the electrons are being occupied in accordance with the Pauli's exclusion principle. And this is the highermost energy level in which the electrons are being filled. And this is the Fermi energy. This is the Fermi energy. But if you try to take the average of all the energy of the electrons from zero to the maximum, the average Fermi energy comes somewhere in the middle. So the average energy is somewhere around here, which is far lesser than the Fermi energy. Now, what will happen if I'm going to increase the temperature? What will happen if I'm going to increase the temperature? There are certain number of electrons from the Fermi level or below the Fermi level, and they try to jump to the higher energy level. And when these electrons are able to jump to the higher energy level, the energy of the electron goes on increases, and hence the Fermi energy also goes on increases. At one particular temperature, as I increase the temperature, the average energy is going to become the Fermi energy. And that temperature is what we call as a Fermi temperature. Therefore, Fermi temperature is the temperature at which the average thermal energy of the free electron in a solid is equal to the Fermi energy at absolute zero Kelvin. And to find out this, we have the Fermi energy at zero Kelvin is equal to K into TF. So we can just write TF is equal to EF by K, where K is the Boltzmann constant. Therefore, just by dividing the Fermi energy by the Boltzmann constant, we are able to calculate the Fermi temperature. And keep in mind, the Fermi temperature is a large temperature because the average energy is going to become the Fermi energy only at very, very high temperatures. Now, let me try to define a terminology called effective mass. When a metal is subjected to the influence of an electric field, a free electron in the metal moves under the combined influence of the applied electric field and that of a periodic potential due to the lattice ions. Because of such a superposed effect, the electron responds as if it possesses a mass called effective mass, which is slightly different from that of the true mass of the electrons. Which means to say that when an electron in the absence of an electric field is going to give us the mass which is same as that of its rest mass, that is 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kg. But when this electron is being subjected by an external electric field, then this electron is not only influenced by itself, but also being influenced by the electric field of the neighboring electrons. And due to which, the mass of the electron is slightly going to change. And the new mass of the electrons in the presence of the external electrons is called as the effective mass. And it has always been represented as M star. Therefore, M star is entirely depends on the total number of electrons that are going to be present in the material. Now, based on this concept, let me try to come across the expression for the electrical conductivity. We have already come across the Sommerfeld theory. And in accordance with the Sommerfeld theory, the free electrons are always going to obey the Fermi-Dirac statistics, which is very similar to that of the gas molecules. And based on this concept, the expression for the electrical conductivity of the metal can be arrived as sigma is equal to n e square lambda divided by m star into Vf. And to get this equation, you see, in the classical mechanics, we have come across this equation. Sigma is equal to n e square tau divided by m. What is tau? Tau is a mean collision time or relaxation time. E is the electronic charge, n is the number of electrons per unit volume, and m is the mass. But tau is nothing but lambda divided by Vf, where lambda is the mean free path and Vf is the Fermi velocity. Similarly, the mass m is been replaced by m star. So, this equation can be replaced using tau is equal to lambda by Vf and m is equal to m star, can be written as sigma is equal to n e square lambda divided by m star into Vf. And this is exactly the expression for the conductivity of metal based on the quantum free electron theory. The reciprocal of this conductivity is called as resistivity, which I can write rho is equal to m star into Vf divided by n e square into lambda. So this is the expression for the resistivity of the material in terms of the quantum free electron theory. Now, based on this quantum free electron theory, let us see what are exactly the merits, because we know the quantum free electron theory successfully explains the drawbacks of the classical free electron theory. So, to understand the merits of the quantum free electron theory, let us try to find the two failures of the classical free electron theory and try to see how the quantum free electron theory successful in explaining the failures of the classical free electron theory. The first failure of the classical free electron theory was temperature dependence of the electrical conductivity. And we observed in the classical free electron theory, the conductivity is inversely proportional to the square root of the temperature. And we very well know that it is not in agreement with the actual theory, because the actual theory says that the conductivity is inversely proportional to the temperature. But let us see how this quantum theory is going to explain the actual dependency of electrical conductivity. According to quantum theory, we have come across the equation sigma is equal to n e square lambda divided by m star into Vf. And this equation says that sigma is proportional to n into lambda divided by Vf, because E square and M star is a constant. They are not depending on the temperature for a given material. Now, let us see whether all these factors are going to change. Here, N is the number of electrons per unit volume of the material, which is independent of the temperature. And we have very well proved that the Fermi energy is independent of the temperature. Naturally, the Fermi velocity also is independent of the temperature. Therefore, we can simply write sigma is proportional to lambda. We can simply write sigma is proportional to lambda. As I very clearly said, EF, which is independent, therefore VF also is temperature independent. But how do I explain this? You see, here lambda is temperature dependent. What is lambda? Lambda is called mean free path. Mean free path is nothing but it is the distance traveled by the electrons between the two successive collisions. It is the average distance traveled by the electrons between the two successive collisions. Now, you look into an atom here. And when you try to apply a very small temperature, the atom starts vibrating from its mean position. And it is going to occupy a certain larger area. Suppose if the temperature has been increased, the same atom is going to occupy in a larger and larger area. Therefore, one thing that I can try to tell you, as the temperature rises, the atom is going to consume larger and larger area. Hence, I can say lambda is reciprocal to E. Why? Because as the area goes on increases, the distance traveled by the electron between the two successive collisions decreases. Therefore, lambda is reciprocal to the area. But area is directly proportional to the temperature. We can very clearly see here, as the temperature rises, the area of the atom occupied also going to be larger. But lambda is reciprocal to the temperature. Lambda is the mean free path. As the temperature increases, the distance traveled by the electron between the two successive collisions is going to decrease. And from this, we can see very clearly, sigma is proportional to lambda as per the above equation, but lambda is reciprocal to the temperature. Hence, I can say sigma is reciprocal to the temperature. And this is exactly the experimental observation. The experimental observation very clearly says that it is clearly going to tell us that the conductivity is reciprocal to the temperature. So as the temperature rises, the conductivity of the metal decreases or the resistivity of the material increases, which is in agreement with the actual theory. And this is the success of explaining the conductivity with respect to the temperature in the quantum free electron theory. And this is the first merit. Let us try to see the second merit. The second failure of the classical free electron theory was the electrical conductivity based on the electron concentration. Where we have seen in the classical mechanics, that sigma proportional to N, and which said more and more number of electrons are present in the material, there is more and more is the conductivity in accordance with the classical free electron theory. But let us try to see the quantum theory. We have come across the equation sigma is equal to N square lambda divided by M star into VF. Here we have N and lambda divided by M star into VF. All are dependent factors. Now, what I do is that let us try to compare two elements. I'll try to take one element as the aluminium and the second element as the copper. So let us try to take two elements and try to compare their conductivity in terms of the number of electrons, in terms of the mean free path, in terms of the M star, that is effective mass, and in terms of the Fermi velocity. If you compare the number of electrons present in the aluminium to that of the number of electrons in the copper, we know electrons in the aluminium is more, it is 18.06 into 10 to the power 28. But in copper, it is less, 8.45 into 10 to the power 28, which means to say that it is 2.137 times the number of electrons in the copper equal to the number of electrons in the aluminium. So here, in accordance with the classical mechanics, we observed that aluminium being large number of electrons would be a better conductor than that of the copper. But actually not true. But if you really look into the second factor, here lambda divided by VF, and if I try to compare lambda by VF of copper to lambda by VF of that of aluminium, it is around 3.373 times that of aluminium. That means The mean free path of the electron with respect to its Fermi velocity in the case of copper is around 3.73 times that of the aluminium, which was not at all taken into consideration in the case of classical free electron theory. Also, if you compare the effective mass of aluminium that of the copper is also equal to 1.08, which means to say that the effective mass of aluminium is 1.08 times more than that of the M star of copper, because aluminium has got more number of electrons, naturally its effective mass increases. Therefore, what I do is that I will try to use this equation and I will try to compare the conductivity of the copper and that of the aluminium, and I can write the equation as sigma of copper to the sigma of aluminium, which is equal to N of copper divided by N of aluminium into lambda by Vf of copper divided by lambda by Vf of aluminium into M star of copper divided by M star of aluminium, because the rest of the factors are getting cancelled each other. And here N of copper divided by N of aluminium is 1 by 2.137. Lambda by Vf divided by lambda by Vf that of aluminium is 3.73 times that of this. But M star of aluminium is greater, around 1.08 times. Therefore, it is 1.08. And if you try to calculate this, it is going to give you 1.62. Which means to say that copper is 1.62 times better conductor than that of the aluminium. And it is a fact. Therefore, in the case of classical mechanics, we observed only the number of electrons in the copper as well as aluminium. And we found that copper is a less conductor than that of aluminium. But we have not at all considered lambda by Vf as well as M star of copper and that of the aluminium. And from this ratio, it has been made very clear, it is very clear that the copper is a better conductor and its conductivity is around 1.62 times better than that of the aluminium. Therefore, the quantum free electron theory successfully explains the drawbacks of the classical free electron theory. Hence, I can say quantum free electron theory is successful in explaining the conductivity of any given matter. So let me try to work out few problems. I have already worked out two problems in my previous lecture. I'll try to work out the third problem. Calculate the Fermi energy and Fermi velocity of a metal at 0 Kelvin, whose density is 10,500 kg per meter cube, and its atomic weight is 107.9, and it has one free electron per atom. Here, given 1 joule is equal to 6.24 into 10 power 28, 18 electrons, because 1 electron volt is equal to 1.602 into 10 power minus 19. And if we try to reciprocate, it is going to give you 1 joule in terms of this. And Avogadro number is equal to 6.025 into 10 power 26 per kilomole. Let us try to see the data given here. So here they have given the density of the material as 10,500 kg per meter cube. And the atomic weight has been given as 107.9. Number of free electrons per atom is going to be equal to 1. So let us first find out how many number of atoms are there per unit volume of the material. You see, to calculate the number of atoms per unit volume of the material, N is given by number of free electrons per atom into the Avogadro number into the density divided by the atomic weight. It is because if you try to take the density times the mass, it has got atomic weight times mass, it has got the Avogadro number. Therefore, the density times mass gives you how much? That has been given by the equation N is equal to number of free electrons per atom into Na into D divided by atomic weight. Now, let us try to substitute. Here, number of electrons per atom is going to be equal to 1. Into Avogadro number is 6.025 into 10 power 26 into the density is 10,500 divided by the atomic weight is 107.9. So if you substitute, we are going to get 5.863 into 10 to the power 28 per meter cube. And this is going to give you the total number of electrons per unit volume of the material. Now, to calculate the Fermi energy, we have the equation EF is equal to H squared divided by 8m into 3 by pi to the power 2 by 3 into n to the power 2 by 3. Here we are already aware the value of H squared by 8m into 3 by pi whole to the power 2 by 3. And if you try to take all these values and try to substitute here, you are going to get 5.85 into 10 to the power minus 38 into 1.5091 into 10 to the power 19, which is equal to 8.83 into 10 to the power minus 19 joules, which I can convert in terms of electron volt by dividing 1.60 to 10 to the power minus 19 electron volt, which is going to give you 5.5 electron volts. So this is the Fermi energy of the substance at 0 Kelvin, which is equal to 5.5 electron volt. Let me try to calculate what is the Fermi velocity also. The equation for the Fermi velocity is Vf is equal to square root of 2F by m. Here Fermi energy has already been calculated as 5.5 electron volts, which is required to be converted in terms of joules by multiplying 1.602 into 10 to the minus 19 and divided by the mass of the electron as 9.11 into 10 to the minus 31, and it is going to give you 1.39 into 10 to the power 6 meter per second, and this is the Fermi velocity of the electrons at the velocity of the electrons at the Fermi level. Thank you.